Good morning and welcome to the third meeting in 2016 of the Health and Sport Committee. I usually do at this point, I can remind everybody to switch off mobile phones, as they can often, at least sometimes, interfere with the sound system. But you'll also note, people in the room, that you will see some of us here at the committee using tablet devices, and this is instead of our hard copies of our papers. Our first item on the agenda today is a decision on whether the committee will consider a draft letter to the finance committee in private at this meeting and any future meetings, as we would normally do. Can I have the committee's agreement? Thank you. Now, I've got trouble with my technology and I can't move on that, so I can introduce people. In fact, what we normally do is we move to our second item, which is our third evidence session in Burial and Cremation, Scotland Bill. First of all, regretfully, I have to announce apologies from Dr. Gillian Smith, the Royal College of Midwives, who's unavoidably been unable to be with us this morning. The other thing I need to say, which I said last week, that the bill that we're examining, and bills by their nature have to be very precise in their meaning and in the language that they use, and as such there may be some language or terminology used this morning for those who are with us and indeed watching and listening to these proceedings in relation to the Burial and Cremation Bill that they may find upsetting. So we wish to apologise in advance if this is the case. It's not our intention to do so, but we have to work with the precise terms of the bill and how it's phrased. As we normally do, Tim, we should have, this would be surprising, might we go round and introduce ourselves at the when there's a round table. My name is Duncan McNeill. I'm the convener of the Health and Sport Committee and the MSP for Greenock and Inverclyde.
My name's Tim Morris, Chief Executive, Institute of Cemetery and Crematorium Management, and the Institute represents burial and cremation authorities throughout the UK and provides training and educational opportunities to those working within the services.
Good morning, I'm Bob Dorris, Member of the Scottish Parliament for Glasgow, and I'm also Deputy Convener of the Health and Sport Committee.
Good morning, I'm Andrew Brown. I'm the Operations Manager for Scotland and Northern Ireland for Co-op Funeral Care, and I'm here today representing the National Association of Funeral Directors.
Good morning, Dennis Robertson, MSP for Aberdeenshire West.
Good morning, I'm Nanette Milne, MSP for North East Scotland, and in view of the fact that the Association of Funeral Directors state that one of the groups they've been involved with is the cross-party group for funerals and bereavements, I should say that I'm a co-convener of that group.
Good morning. My name is Jim Brodie. Apologies, I have a slight stammer. That's why they send somebody like me to these meetings to slow things down. I'm an independent private funeral director based in West Lothian. I am here representing the Scottish Society of Allied and Independent Funeral Directors, funeral director for over 30 years, third generation. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Colin Keir, MSP for Edinburgh Western.
Good morning, Richard Lyle, MSP for Central Region.
My name is Sandy Young, I'm Head of Service for NHS Lothian for Spiritual Care and Bereavement, and in particular in my own bereavement casework, that has been for many years in helping those bereaved in the context of pregnancy loss and baby loss.
Hello, I'm Caroline Pretty, I'm Bereavement Service Coordinator for NHS Lothian and also work with a particular focus within the organisation in women's and children's services.
Rhoda Grant, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Natalie McKail, I'm the Senior Manager within City of Edinburgh Council and have responsibility for the Morton Hall Improvement Programme, working to the Chief Executive's Working Group.
Malcolm Chisholm, MSP for Edinburgh, Northern and Leith.
Mike McKenzie, MSP for Highlands and Islands Region.
Thank you all for that. Now that's done, just before we move to open up the session, and for the benefit of the witnesses, can I say that we're covering a wide range of topics here today. Some of them will be applicable to you. Some of you feel you can answer some, you know. So there's no pressure to respond to every subject if it's not in your area of interest. Although the whole point of having a panel here today is to get your input. So when the area of your interests are, then please, if you feel it appropriate, to participate. And you do that just by catching my eye, and I'll bring you in. And I've given Tim the information that he's got to just nudge me because he's out my eyesight. So you know. So, but just to get things going, can we have a question from Malcolm Chisholm, and then we'll take it from there, folks. Thank you.
I'd like to thank you very much for your very, very useful evidence. So I thought, trying to break it down into different areas, if we could start with the disposing of remains from pregnancy loss at or before the 24th week. And I thought there were many interesting comments there, but I'm just focusing at the moment on NHS Lothian, because I think they raised some important concerns in general, which we need to think about. But certainly in that section, they've got a couple of concerns, one of which is to do with the seven-day period, which is also an issue that came up when we met some of the parents who have been affected by this informally last week. So if we could, you know, think in that particular area to begin with, that would be particularly useful. And there's one other issue that came up in that informal meeting as well, which some of you may want to comment on. People seem to think, in terms of the way the bill was worded, that before 24 weeks, the mother was allowed, you know, to arrange the funeral herself and could leave the hospital with the baby or the fetus up to the 24-week point. So there's a whole range of issues there. I don't know if NHS Lothian want to start off with their concerns that they've raised about the period up to 24 weeks.
I think within that sort of under 24-week period, there's such a huge range of circumstances of loss. So the current guidance from the Scottish Government on disposal of losses under 24 weeks covers everything from a very early miscarriage, terminations of pregnancy for medical and non-medical reasons, later miscarriages, ectopic pregnancies. So huge range of different circumstances where it's very difficult to sort of navigate that complicated territory in terms of clinical care, in terms of the medical support to women, as well as the different sort of emotional and psychological interpretations of the women involved. And I think we were just concerned in terms of some of the timescales, in terms of some of the process side of things, that if, as I think was discussed in the meeting last week, there might be a robustness in asking people to come back and confirm their authorisation for disposal at a later date, or in holding off from signing any final authorisation until a later point, whilst on the one hand that serves the purpose of allowing people space and time to make an informed decision at a point where perhaps they're not so emotionally vulnerable. On the other hand, for some women, it's not an issue that they want to think necessarily long and hard about. So in many of these procedures, disposal will be authorised prior to a termination or a medical management of a miscarriage. And it's not necessarily something that those women involved want to revisit or want to be followed up about. The current guidance allows a seven-day cooling-off period, for want of a better term, and that does seem to work quite effectively in terms of allowing those individuals who either want to leave the hospital undecided and get back to us with a decision at a later date to do so, or to have a period of time where they can revisit, change their decision, contact a designated person to discuss things in more detail. It's worrying for me to sort of put a routine seven-day delay into legislation when perhaps that wouldn't best serve a person-centred and flexible approach to care of women in these varying circumstances.
And would also create particular difficulties for us because the draft legislation as framed for early loss focuses on what we would think of as a minimum good practice, but not necessarily best practice. So in some health boards, at under 24 weeks, and also with those who have suffered a stillbirth, the hospital's concern will offer to people an individual hospital arrangement for a funeral with or without a ceremony, rather than simply the group default arrangement. So while we welcome the recommendations of the Morton Hall report and the Scottish Government's commission feeding into this legislation, focusing on things like giving time and space for decision making and the opportunity to reconnect, that is a different matter when the choice is one thing, either let the health plan continue with a group arrangement or opt out for an individual private process. That's a fairly simple, sad and tragic circumstance, but a fairly simple choice. But when a health board is trying to offer a range of possibilities for people, both up to 24 weeks and also for those who have suffered stillbirth, that becomes a much more complicated process. The legislation so far seems to address in detail the healthcare provider's responsibility under 24 weeks, but lets the stillbirth group sit alongside those who have suffered a perinatal or a neonatal death with the assumption of private family responsibility. That's not currently how it's done under the auspices of many health boards in Scotland.
Can you give us a for example consequence of that to help us understand the difficulties in around that?
Yes. A for example would be to talk about a very difficult group of bereaved families with very difficult decisions and circumstances. Those who have made a decision about the termination of a pregnancy for medical reasons, perhaps with a little one who has a condition which is incompatible with life outside the womb, for example. In NHS Lothian, when that happens in the second trimester, so up to sort of 12 to 24 week sort of period, the majority at the moment opt for the hospital to help make an individual arrangement. Some make a private arrangement, but the majority opt for the hospital, either hospital in Lothian, when both options, private and hospital supported, are offered. The majority ask currently the hospital to help make that arrangement. There are also rare circumstances where different pieces of legislation have friction points between them, and we have to work with people who are caught in those circumstances. The three pieces of legislation I'm thinking about in particular is the Abortion Act and also the legislation which covers the registration of birth, deaths and marriages. So, for example, the Abortion Act allows for a person in rare but certainly occurring circumstances to have a medical termination in the third trimester of pregnancy. But the legislation governing the registration of birth, deaths and marriages also requires that person to register a stillbirth. So that is a particularly challenging situation. And if health board staff do not continue to offer support for people for individual hospital arrangement towards funeral, then they will also, as well as having the difficult decisions about the loss and also to have to register a stillbirth of that little one, they will also have to make private arrangements for their funeral. So our question is, can we have more consideration of third trimester circumstances of loss and the complexities that go with them, and the question considered of whether those suffering a stillbirth should be treated in an entirely analogous way to those who have suffered the perinatal or neonatal death of a baby. We think they're different circumstances with a range of complexity and nuance within them, and that currently what we think is best practice allows hospital staff to help people towards an individual arrangement, whether or not it's private. If the legislation goes forward as it currently stands, we would find no legislative framework supporting that work in the third trimester.
And your, sorry,
Yes, please.
Your worst case scenario would be that following a stillbirth, we could be left with no means to arrange a funeral. If either the woman who experienced the stillbirth was unable or unwilling to make arrangements for the funeral, bearing in mind if this is a termination in the third trimester, it's likely, if it's not a medical abnormality, that it is her own health, medical or physical, or psychiatric, that's in at grave risk, then we could be left in those circumstances with no means to arrange a funeral or disposal for a stillborn baby in those circumstances, because the list of nearest relatives in the bill as drafted doesn't include anybody unrelated to that stillborn baby to make arrangements.
Would it be helpful? It would probably be helpful to me, but about all the different terms, I suppose, through to, and I think there's an opportunity to ask some of these questions today in terms of, there was a campaign today about, you know, the extent of miscarriages in the United Kingdom, about 250,000 or something. So you've got miscarriage, you've got stillbirth, you've got infant mortality. You know, what is the different terminology is used that I think we need to understand the
neither of us is a clinician, so
and the services that you said you provided earlier, Mr. Young, you know, to right across the board, so
within NHS Lothian, once a lady is booked in as a maternity patient, so that's going to be the beginning of the second trimester, stops being a gynaecology patient, begins to be a maternity patient. At that point, if she suffers a loss of any sort, there will be support offered for an individualised process currently. So in the period of 12 to 24 weeks, the basic government guidance would allow a minimum standard of hospital group arrangements or a private opt-out for an individual funeral. Within NHS Lothian, the individual option for hospital-supported arrangement and hospital-funded arrangement continues through the second trimester. The circumstances of loss which a person may suffer, this is where my clinical knowledge is obviously lacking, but miscarriage is more common in first trimester, becomes less common in second trimester. And in second trimester and in third trimester, not all, there are many tragic, unanticipated circumstances of loss, but most losses are known about some time before the delivery of the fetus or baby, either because there's a planned medical termination of a pregnancy or because tests have shown that there is no fetal heartbeat and the fetus has died in the womb. And that means that in our context, most often midwives are talking to people in a context of a shared understanding that a loss has already occurred and that the little one is going to be delivered. And that's also a question for us in relation to when we consult with people in the 7-day period, because it would be good practice for a midwife speaking to a woman who's about to go through a procedure which will lead to the birth of a stillborn child or a fetus earlier, to tell her and discuss with her what's going to happen afterwards. And some of that discussion will be around, does she want to see the baby and spend some time with the baby or not? And also some explanation of how they may proceed with final active care choices and decisions. So I think the range of circumstance there in a hospital setting and the nuance that comes with that is not yet provided for in this, not providing for us a legislative framework now. And the risk is, which would be tragic given the genesis of all this work in recent years, the risk is that a risk-averse, safe approach to practice would be for us to minimise what we do and go back to simply observing the government standard under 24 weeks, which would be group arrangement or you proceed privately.
Yeah, but just one final question. I just need to get how, for that 12 to 24 weeks and right through, do we know how many And can we anticipate how many women would find themselves in that situation? What are the national figures for this? You know, how many women, families would find themselves affected by this legislation? Do we know? We can ask the minister when they come along.
Yep. It's not current knowledge, but the last time I looked at that, it was 2 to 2.5% of pregnancies that get to the beginning of the second trimester end in some form of loss. So in hospitals where there are many thousands of births of little ones in an annual basis, there will be a few hundred circumstances of loss.
Yeah. Bob, and Dennis?
I was kind of... We got some evidence in relation to this last week as well off of impacted parents. I'm just wondering the reality on the ground in relation to NHS staff who have to deal with the pregnancy loss, unfortunately, sometimes in very early stages on a daily basis, I suppose, across the country, and whether it's a miscarriage, and sometimes miscarriages are predicted, so mum and dad will know that the baby won't survive, and they may go home and the miscarriage may take place at home or may have to be brought into hospital, sometimes planned, sometimes unexpectedly if things don't go according to plan. I'm just wondering how NHS staff on the ground, how aware they are of what they should currently do in relation to dealing sensitively, say, with a mum who appears at A&E with severe pain because the failing pregnancy at home is not going as it was anticipated, or they go into hospital, because it's not always specialists who deal with this thing at the coalface within the NHS. So I know there are systems in place across the country with NHS boards to try and deal with this sensitively at the moment, but I suspect maybe they can't always do that because they don't have the experience or the training. So what's the situation like at the moment? And is this bill an opportunity to raise awareness within the NHS to deal more sensitively with them? And I'm thinking more particularly about mums before 24 weeks, will be dealt with differently within the NHS. So where are we just now, and is this an opportunity maybe to improve what we do?
I think it's a significant challenge to ensure that midwives in particular on the ground are up to date, well informed, as confident as one can be going into such a difficult and sensitive situation with individuals experiencing pregnancy loss and stillbirth. And there probably is a lot more that could be done. Clearly, concerns about previous practice has brought a lot of focus to this area, and there's been some really good work going on to improve staff development, to improve development of resources and information and processes. But necessarily it's going to be difficult and it's going to be complicated. And I think it will always be hard for generalist staff to hold the degree of detail in their minds for those occasions, which are common but not everyday occurrences, where they will be supporting women and their partners experiencing pregnancy loss and death of a baby. So that's the challenge with any type of specialist knowledge, I think, that needs to be delivered by generalist staff. We could probably do more to develop specialist roles within midwifery and within maternity services and bereavement services in NHS in Scotland generally, which I think we recognise are maybe some way behind what's provided for south of the border in major hospitals, where it's far more routine to have a bereavement department, to have specialist staff. That's not the case across the NHS in Scotland. And I think given this legislation, given recent changes to death certification, cultural change, social issues around funeral poverty that I know this bill and this committee are also interested in, as you say, Bob, there might be an opportunity here to use this to improve and develop how the NHS supports bereaved families, both in relation to these types of loss and generally in relation to bereavement and death of patients.
Yes, please.
Briefly, I'm also part of the Infant Cremation Steering Group. They have an education part, and we're quite far advanced there with having advanced information and training modules to go through the whole of the NHS in Scotland regarding a code of practice, but also education and modules for all staff in the NHS to go through as part of their continuous professional development.
Yes, please, Natalie.
I think there's also another opportunity through the focus that we have following on from the Dame Elish investigation and also the Lord Bonamy report and the contents of the bill to ensure that there's significant collaboration across the different agencies who are involved in supporting the bereaved in Scotland. That's certainly something that we've been focusing on, given the expressed loss of confidence from some midwives in relation to explaining the process of cremation here in Edinburgh. And that's certainly something that we're working very closely with NHS colleagues to address.
Thanks for that. No other panel members there? No. Is this Dennis? Yes. Dennis, and I think, has got a question.
Thank you, Convener. It really is just a bit of clarification on some of the points that have been mentioned so far. We hear about, you know, offering support, and I think what I'm gathering is that it's generally midwives, but is that across the board? Is that across all health boards that it's the midwife, or do we have specialist nurses, whether it be midwives or not, providing that support? And at what point does the offer of meeting with a funeral director take place? Because sometimes cremation may not be the preferred choice; it could be burial. And I'm just wondering, you know, how sensitively we sort of approach that, and at what point can the funeral director actually come in as well?
I think it varies in terms of different health boards and the processes that they follow. So as Sandy alluded to, some have for some time now provided the model in the current Scottish Government guidance for under 24 weeks offering a shared cremation or an opt-out to make private arrangements. Others, as we say, NHS Lothian, for example, offer a range of different options depending on circumstances of loss and the woman or the parent's choice. It would generally be within maternity services, midwives that we would expect to have most of those conversations. However, often chaplains, specialist midwives or those with a particular interest in bereavement or in some cases bereavement services, individuals such as myself. So it varies. I think we're also thinking about, you know, these are women and their partners at an incredibly vulnerable time. So whilst you want people to have good detailed knowledge and access to a specialist resource to answer any detailed questions, you also don't necessarily want even more unfamiliar faces parachuting in at a time when people feel, you know, very vulnerable and in what's really very difficult and intimate experience. So it's getting that balance between having frontline staff able, confident to provide necessary information, but also having the specialist resource that they or that families can draw on as required. I think there's some Anne McMurray said in the previous session, there's maybe one designated specialist midwife in the NHS in Scotland at the moment. That type of role, I think, can bring benefits in terms of staff support, training, development, role modelling. It's not necessarily the answer to having a resource available at all times, because it is person dependent. That person will probably be allowed to go on holiday or be sick or have other things going on. So it's not necessarily the panacea for all health boards to have a specialist role, but maybe to think more broadly about what specialist resources required for bereavement in a range of circumstances.
Jim, you want to respond to that?
As from an independent funeral director's point of view, the vast majority of families that we handle or help with infant loss, it's usually for a burial. We, as an independent funeral director, we do very few infant cremations. And it's we quite often find it's when there's been a breakdown in trust between the family and the NHS that can happen. So we do tend to find quite a lot that the infants that we handle are usually for a burial. Most of the hospital organised cremations are done through contracts or agreements with the different funeral directors, and it's usually the larger hospitals in the metropolitan area. But say, in my 30 years, I have probably handled 1,000 infant deaths, of which 900-950 easily would be for an earth burial. Very few cremation.
And do you want to come in the back of that?
Yeah, just to very briefly make the point that many of the members of the National Association of Funeral Directors will carry out contract funerals on behalf of the NHS boards, but there is quite a variety in the way that is treated. And I know both Caroline and Sandy have already made the point about the arrangements in Lothian, where you can, through the hospital, arrange for an individual cremation, irrespective of the gestation period. And I think it would be a shame to lose that flexibility, because currently, as I say, it varies from one place to another, whether the only thing that's on offer is a shared cremation, or whether there is, in fact, an individual hospital contract funeral available. But we experience families who would not want to have a shared cremation, but also would not want to take the full responsibility of going to a funeral director of choice to arrange the entire funeral. So I think it would be important that is allowed for within the legislation going forward.
Yes,
just a Sandy. Point of clarification. In the Lothians, the hospitals offer the possibility of individual cremation, but also individual burial, where there is a designated baby area in a cemetery. So that's very much working in consultation with local authorities.
Okay, we'll get to some of that. Nanette?
I'm speaking from being at the informal meeting last week as well, where it came across, I think there's a lot of good practice going on within Lothian, which is not necessarily repeated across the rest of the country. But the concerns were expressed that in a busy unit with busy midwives, there may not be just the physical time for midwives to give the support that's really necessary. And I think there's felt maybe a need for someone whose role is purely counselling in these sort of situations. And I know that some people from SANS are actually training as counsellors just to cope with this sort of situation. I just wondered what the view was on perhaps trying to have a counselling service within hospitals across the country, and not just for the support and deciding what to do, but actually completing the forms, because I think there was some concern that a form was put in front of parents and, you know, more or less filled in for them and sign here, and they really weren't terribly sure at the end of the day because of the emotional turmoils and just exactly what they were signing up to. I just wonder if any comments around that sort of area.
To that, because I think that's a natural progress, you know, until we get to the, you know, the events happened and we can move on to that. There's just two other things, well, one other thing really that we could cover, is that while we understand the vast majority of these situations will happen within hospital and the NHS, the issue of prison and residential settings has also been raised with. If we could just tidy that up in terms of the arrangements that would apply in these settings, which is anyone aware of, you know? I mean, I think we can visualise it in a hospital setting. It may be that it wouldn't happen in a prison setting. I don't know, they would be taken to the hospital of a situation, but there's no knowledge round about the table about the arrangement. The funeral undertakers, I know similar arrangements there in terms of prisons or a residential setting. Or no. Well, it's maybe something we can raise with the minister. But just going on now to maybe some of the issues that arise around the events happened. That engagement has begun to take place, and then we're into the issues of, if you like, using the negative bureaucracy, forum filling. We're into areas about time, religious and cultural issues that arise there about when a burial or a cremation or any service should take place. So I think if we can start picking up on some of these issues, Sandy. Yeah,
just to say, it may be helpful to understand how a lady's care is managed in terms of time in hospital after a pregnancy loss or the stillbirth, for example. Most ladies, if the lady is fit and well and physically after the delivery of the little one, will go home in 1 or 2 days. So here we'd want to make a clear distinction between counselling, which is grief and bereavement counselling, which belongs some way after a loss, in most circumstances of loss, rather than at the moment of, and accurate, clear information given to facilitate decisions, final act of care decisions. And a good thing, which is in the new legislation as it currently stands, is time for decision making, which we would absolutely support. But obviously time for decision making in health boards, where that could be individual reconnection with health board staff in the majority of cases, is a different matter from time for reconsideration, a simple, sad but simple choice between are you going to proceed privately or go to a default group arrangement system. So how we manage that effectively within NHS Lothian or any other health board where they choose to, in my view, continue to exceed a basic standard, then there's a significant challenge in that. How do we create a single point of contact for somebody who's reconnecting with a hospital after that 7 days has passed, wants to meet somebody? If it's one bereavement counsellor employed by a board, how does that work in terms, actual practical terms of meeting the needs of people? So generalist approaches need to continue so that the staff who are actually working with people in the little time periods when they're actually there are able to engage effectively with them. And specialist roles are helpful, but we do not currently exist in a world where we are resourced to get that specialist role to somebody in that 8 hours, 12 hours, 24 hours that they may be in hospital.
Yeah, certainly.
I'm talking to when you're now, as I say, presented with the forms that you have to fill up, that sort of thing. And there did seem to be a gap there that not everyone was coming with what you might say the appropriate clinical attitude to form filling. It was just very much a business-like thing. You know, do you want this, do you want that? And then a form to sign. And some of them felt they hadn't really time to think about it. And that's understandable in a busy maternity unit. And I just wondered if there's a way around that sort of problem.
Again, coming from the infant cremations steering group, there is a new code of practice where the parents will be handed a copy of everything that they have signed. So no matter what is filled out, they will get a copy. Okay. Now this is a code of practice which has been adopted, but it hasn't been rolled out yet. So there's a huge amount of work being completed there. You will find that what you're talking about, yes, will start to fade. The problem you have is that the forms, they're not conducive to making it easy for a parent who just went through a loss. The holding off for 1 week is helpful because it gives them a chance to get their head around what's happened. But I say the most important thing is there has got to be transparency, which is coming through slowly, gradually, but it is coming through. So the code of practice is going to address quite a lot of what you were actually talking about.
As a
As a cremation authority or a burial authority, we would want to be assured that the individual and the family around that individual have been afforded appropriate levels of support, because one of the things that came through strongly in the Morton Hall response and ongoing engagement with affected parents was, just as you've described, they felt that they didn't really understand on occasion what was being asked of them and the potential consequences of completing the paperwork. So that's certainly something, in order for us to be reassured that we are carrying out the appropriate final act of care on behalf of these individuals, that due time and support has been put in place, because ultimately it is a final act of care.
Yeah, the information given to bereaved parents is vitally important. It needs to be consistent, and the same information needs to be delivered by all involved, and I believe that that's also going to come out of the National Committee. So it sets a level standard and provides bereaved parents with the information that they need in order to make decisions that are correct for themselves.
I think there's a balance as well between recognising that for some women they may want to make a decision, yes, have a period of time to maybe revisit that and change it, but maybe quite, you know, secure in what they've decided. Whereas for others, it's perfectly understandable to go away undecided, to reconnect. My concern would be if we have to routinely wait 7 weeks, some women may be particularly difficult to re-engage with, and then you have the issue of not having any authorisation whatsoever. My preference would be to take authorisation where a woman is able to do so around about the time of the loss, but allow, you know, absolutely robust processes to reconnect, to revisit that and to change it if necessary. But that does at least mean that for those women who will not come back a week later to go through paperwork, we have something authorised in their name. And then we know after a week that we can presume that they've decided to remain with that decision, rather than saying, have they not signed because someone didn't give them the form? Have they not signed because the form wasn't well explained at the time?
I thought you were Jim there. Again, the Code of Practice, there is a provision there that if there is no engagement after a period of a time from the parent, then the health board will have the right to carry on. But again, this is Code of Practice, this isn't legislation.
Right. The thing that's also a little worrying, the legislation as it's drafted, as we've mentioned in the written feedback, is that it's not a right to proceed. As it's written in the current bill, it is a duty to arrange the funeral or the final act of care after the initial period and the relevant period has expired. So essentially 6 weeks after the loss, the board in this version has a duty to proceed. I think we would be familiar with circumstances where actually a woman might want to make her own arrangements but hasn't been able to do so within that time frame. Now, that might be due to waiting for genetic testing, for confirmation of gender, for example, which can take several weeks, results of post-mortem examinations. If they don't want to use a baby area where typically a lair would be provided free of charge, they might want to arrange a burial in a paid-for lair. There's a significant cost attached to that in most areas. They may need to apply for a funeral payment, which can take several weeks. There's all sorts of reasons why I'd be concerned about the six-week cut-off putting a duty on a health board to act. I'm happier with the wording Jim's described, that you then have a right to act, or a duty to act, unless there's cause shown as to why you should hold off or try to reconnect with the woman. But a six-week cut-off, and then you have to arrange the final act of care, I wouldn't be comfortable with.
Colin, did you want to come in this summer?
Yeah, it was really on, kind of on the back of that, and it was in relation to the fact that the bill has a ranked list of relatives who would be able to make a decision. Is this helpful? Are there any problems about the ranking of the relatives, so to speak, if they were coming into a decision? And given the fact that after 24 weeks, terminations are considered stillbirths, there's the issues of possible confidentiality issues that may spring up. And I was looking just on the back of where you've taken the discussion so far as to how you would be thinking in terms of these issues.
I'd like to comment on that. Just in very general terms, when people are bereaved in pregnancy, the earlier the loss, the smaller the circle of people who will be in the know, potentially. And obviously, with later loss, there'll be much greater knowledge within a family. So, yes, of course it's helpful to have that list of responsible people, but it still remains for the woman herself and partner, if there's a partner involved at the time, to make their own decisions about how much of their personal experience they want to share with those relatives. And it could be the case that particularly in the earlier loss, where the circle of those in the family who have already been included in knowledge about the loss is relatively small, then the use of that list would be difficult, as it would also be where, for other sad and difficult circumstances, people have disordered or chaotic lives.
Yes. Sorry, I was going to say, I think in general the list of nearest relatives is helpful from a healthcare perspective, the fact that it mirrors the Human Tissue Act, or Human Tissue Scotland Act. It is useful because it will be a framework people will be familiar with in terms of post-mortem examination authorisation. Mostly sort of out with the area of maternity and obstetric loss that we've been thinking about in terms of adult deaths or sadly some child deaths, there will sometimes be disputes within a family and having that type of hierarchy is useful. It would be useful if other relevant areas of legislation like registration of deaths had the same hierarchy, because otherwise we'll have this anomaly that a qualified informant would be a relative, but only a nearest relative could then go on to organise the funeral. So that would be an anomaly that would be useful to resolve. But leaving that hierarchy of nearest relatives for an adult death or a baby or stillbirth without recourse to other arrangements being made is a bit of a problem for me, particularly in the circumstances we've described where it's a stillbirth, and particularly where it may be a termination for medical reasons after 24 weeks. So the Abortion Act and regulations would preclude us from contacting any other nearest relative. We wouldn't be able to register and proceed with a funeral in that case. The regulations in England and Wales from 2008, which I know are under review at the moment, are quite useful in terms of putting a kind of fallback position in regulation, so that aside from the list of nearest relatives, there is also a form of words about another individual can approach a cremation authority and apply to arrange a funeral on cause shown, and that might be something useful to think about, because you'll also have circumstances where it might not be a blood relative or an executor or a friend of long standing. So I'm thinking about perhaps people who die in care homes or nursing homes, where management of that facility may organise funerals for residents who die in their care who don't have any known next of kin and haven't left instructions. That seems an appropriate arrangement and one that's not covered in this legislation.
Jim, did you want to supplement that in any way? Or?
That's fine.
And no one else on that area? No. Yes, go on.
To say that we as funeral directors would agree with that, because it's rare, but we do occasionally come up with situations where there is a dispute in the family and there's uncertainty from our perspective as to who to take instruction from, but that would certainly assist. And likewise, when there are no family members, so in the circumstances Caroline was describing about people who are in some sort of care facility, that would certainly be to our benefit as well.
Richard, are you going to go into something in light of something else?
Yes, in regards to forms.
Oh, is it forum? No, that's good then. No, that's what I was... I think the forum's easy. Please, Richard. Yeah.
Thank you, convener. We've heard from two separate... the committee's heard from two separate types of witnesses who basically were on about the number of forms. One witness suggested that there should be quite a number of forms coping with all the different situations. And let me say that there are so many different situations of death, both child and elderly and ordinary situations. But basically, the bill explains that a single application form will be used to record all applications for crematorium, including cremations or remains from pregnancy loss. But NHS Lothian, in their submission, raised some concerns about a single form to cover all cremations, arguing it may be distressing to parents to see irrelevant questions such as a marital status or an occupation of a deceased or even a form that's basically, you know, war and peace situation, and tick that and don't tick that, and that can be very distressing for people. The Institute of Cemetery and Cremation also suggested that separate forms for infants stillborn pregnancy losses are preferable so as to remove inappropriate questions. So can I ask two people who know exactly what's happening, what would you prefer, one form or multiple forms where we can be very supportive of the people who sadly have just had a loss?
My opposition to the proposed new A form has been noted several times. I know why the one form means it's one form for everybody, it's standard, it's ideal. But what I have to say is that 99.9% of all cremation forms filled out for every cremation in Scotland is completed by the funeral director asking the client the questions, explaining it through. Clients are not interested in looking at these questions. They've lost someone, they just want it to happen. The forms go back to 1902, I believe, where cremation was extremely rare. Now cremation is probably 75-80% of the method of disposal in Scotland. People look at these forms as a necessary pain, I'll be very honest. No matter how much we educate and train funeral directors, there are guys who will, or funeral rangers, who will just rattle through it. Recently, if I can just digress, recently at one of the last meetings, an affected parent, she had vented her frustration that nothing seems to have happened since the scandal broke. And my answer to her was actually, everything has changed dramatically. Within a matter of months of the scandal, virtually every crematorium in Britain, well, Scotland especially, changed their own forms, non-statutory forms, where Ashes' instruction was very, very clear, and we had to go through it very carefully with the client to get the information. And even then, most crematoriums will not dispose of ashes until 28 days after the cremation has taken place, so people can still change their mind. So a huge amount has already happened, even before the infant cremation steering group started. My major problem with the form is that the vast majority of cremations in Scotland are adult. I walk into a family home, there's a lady there who's lost her husband. She's got arthritis or whatever. And I've got to get her to sign a form, sometimes six times. Then I have another form from the crematorium, their own non-statutory forms, basically asking the same questions. So it does make it a lot harder for the clients. I've spent a lot of time in America, and believe it or not, in a lot of states in America, you get a death certificate. The funeral director is actually a registrar. He's licensed by the state, so he's a registrar. You can do what you want. If you've got a death certificate, there's no application forms for cremation, burial, anything. I'm not in favour of that, but times have changed so much. Cremation is now the norm. I had a chat with several crematorium staff over the past few months and asked them, what do they need on the application form? What they've said to me is what they need is obviously the basic information about the person who has died, but they don't need a lot of medical stuff because we don't have a medical referee. These people are superintendents of the crematorium. They have no medical expertise. So a lot of the medical questions are a waste of time. They just need to know that the death has been legally registered. They have a Form 14 from the registrar which allows the cremation to take place. But they also need clear instructions regarding the disposal or retention of ashes. And they also need a clear affidavit from the funeral director that the construction of the coffin meets the requirements for the environmental protection. So, long and short of it, one form for adults, one form for children, one form for infants and determination, I would say, because otherwise it's going to be massive and it's cumbersome. If it goes to a digital format, slightly different, you answer one question, it misses a lot out. But at the moment, you're talking about five or six pages of pain that the family really don't want to go through. And that's my personal opinion.
Andrew? I think the key important factor about the application form for cremation is that it is the same across all crematoria. At the moment, we have a wide variety. And as Jim spoke about, crematoria have introduced supplementary forms, which many of them are asking exactly the same questions. I do understand that some crematoria have specific questions. You know, they may perhaps have an alternative music system. They may offer the opportunity to webcast the funeral. Those are things that are not offered by every crematorium, and therefore they would require a separate document for that. But I think the key thing is that the questions and the forms are the same across all crematoria. One of the concerns we have is about having the same form for adult, stillborn and non-viable fetus. And the NAFD would certainly prefer that there were either three separate forms, or if it is one form, that is one form with selectable parts to it. So we as the funeral director could print off the relevant part of that form, so we're not presenting someone who's just lost an elderly member of their family with a form that contains detail about infant death, which is irrelevant to that family and may upset them further. So that would be our preference. And likewise, the intention of the bill of having a standard application for burials would be extremely helpful. I think the population of Scotland are becoming more mobile. There are more people who will perhaps be arranging a funeral in one part of the country for a service and cremation or burial taking place in another part of the country. So there are all sorts of practical reasons why having the same form for every burial authority and every cremation authority would be useful. But as I say, it would still be preferential for us to have individual forms for the three categories of cremation.
Yeah, the Institute obviously supports separate forms. If I can just dwell on the application form for pre-24-week babies, as Andrew has said, a statutory form for those instances will promote standardisation across all cremation authorities, which I think is vitally important. Just one word on burial forms. I would also agree a statutory burial form because a lay purchaser purchases a right of burial and that's registered in a statutory register, then the proper information needs to be transferred from the application to the statutory register. And when it comes to reopening a lay for a second or subsequent burial, then the authority would have to ensure that the registered owner's rights were being maintained. So a statutory form for both initial purchase of a lair and subsequent use of a lair, we think is ideal.
Natalie?
To reiterate the points that have already been made in relation to, on behalf of a cremation and burial authority, we would like to see a consistency of approach across Scotland. Andrew made the point in relation to our customers being very mobile, but also to make sure that the expectations that we have on staff, whether it's within the private or public sector, are very clearly articulated. And I think a consistency of approach in documentation terms actually reinforces that. So we will have the same type of practice across Scotland and hopefully through changes down south. So that creates a network of common practice across the United Kingdom.
Yes, Andy.
Consistency would be such a great help in our setting because health board areas are not coterminous with single local authorities. So in Lothian, we're talking about four local authorities. A small example would be that in some set-aside baby areas, the local authority will treat the bereaved woman or family as a lair holder and give them their papers of ownership, and in some local authorities, they won't. So the amount of information that people who are having first consultations in a health board context need to know currently, where there isn't consistency of practice across the country, is potentially quite vast. And that's why, increasingly, the midwife working directly with the person concerned needs to call for additional help, because questions are asked that relate to all that complexity and plethora of possibilities, because there is not a standard approach across the country.
Bob?
I won't ask about whether it's one, two or three forums. What I took from the other evidence session we had was that whatever key questions have to be asked should be asked very sensitively, they should be asked consistently, and that families should properly understand what it is they're agreeing or not agreeing to. And that led on to the idea about the paperwork could all be perfect. We could go and check the paperwork, it could all be signed properly. Indeed, with the Baby's Ashes scandal, quite often the paperwork would appear to be perfect. The issue was about people didn't know what they were signing up to or if they'd signed up to something. So no matter how fantastic we make the forums, whether it's one forum or three forums or five forums, in one respect that's powerful and important, but in another respect that's not the issue for, I suspect, many parents. It will be knowing that their wishes are clearly requested and they're clearly carried out, and they can trust that convener. So I suppose what I would ask, and this was raised in evidence last week, was how do we make sure that just because it says something on the forum, that is what has happened, and that parents that have suffered loss are very, very clear that that is what's happened. So how do we put checks and balances into the system without re-traumatising bereaved parents? And that seems to be a significant challenge, and it was unclear. There were some suggestions last week on how we do that, but I think it was unclear what the best way ahead was. So I'd be interested to know what people think about that, because it's difficult to legislate for a sensitive, sympathetic, empathetic conversation between a funeral director or a nurse at hospital or at the funeral directors themselves. So how do you build that into the system but have a check and balance to make sure it's not just the paperwork that's right, but there was proper comprehension shown at the time where it was signed?
Jim?
It's quite well handled by the code of practice, I have to say, because it covers all three parties: the hospital, the funeral director and the crematoria. As I say, we could train people to their nth degree, but you can't train care, you can't train empathy. The vast majority of funeral directors, that's what we do, you know. And I'm pretty sure that every funeral director will explain to every client that the scattering of ashes is an irreversible act, as is the process of cremation. Part of the arguments with the new A forms, because I was arguing against less amount of signatures, but the most important thing is on the disposal of the ashes, that we do have it clearly explained and assigned for. Now currently it's not on the form, on the A form, but it's on every crematorium's supplementary forms, which has to be clearly signed for. So I would say a lot of the errors and mistakes of the past wouldn't happen again, even if we didn't change a thing. I have to say that.
Excuse me, Natalie, I've just give Tim the floor here, and I'll bring you in, certainly. Tim?
Yeah, I think that, as has been discussed at the National Committee level, consistent information and an audit trail of decisions made is probably the nearest that
can
be achieved.
Natalie?
Just in relation to that, the openness and transparency around record keeping and decision making, I think, is proposed to be much improved. So, for example, having a copy of the form that you completed at the time, so that you can perhaps at a later stage consult with friends and family around, you know, the documentation to ensure that the register is open and publicly accessible for whatever final act of care you have chosen. I think these are really important steps for individuals who perhaps want to be reassured that that final act of care has been carried out according to their wishes. So I know that documentation isn't the be-all and end-all of this scenario, but with additional training, collaboration across the different agencies, allowing a supportive decision to be made, and then those checks and balances can be made through review of the documentation, I think that provides a much more supportive and open atmosphere for individuals.
The documentation itself doesn't prove that, those conversations have taken place. I think by having a statutory document for pre-24 weeks forces that. Many of the issues around the Ashes scandal were pre-24 weeks, and it was because there is no statutory document, and there were documents submitted to crematoria with minimal information, and clearly the questions hadn't been asked. The documents will force those questions to be asked either by a funeral director or by someone in a hospital setting. And yes, as Jim said, the code of practice insists on adequate training being in place. And certainly from the funeral director's perspective, it's not unique to infant funerals, but any funeral we arrange is with bereaved people who are not perhaps taking in all the information that you're giving them. So the documentation for everything around funerals is critical. Having copies of everything that has been agreed is important, so that they can reflect on decisions that have been made once they're perhaps in a better frame of mind to do so.
Just to cover some of the other areas that we hadn't been covered as yet, that I suppose some of the more sensitive areas, in terms of, we understand that the vast majority will be burials, but there are, in terms of child, that's what you said earlier, wasn't it?
Independent directors.
Aye, right.
The children we tend to deal with are mostly burials. It's most of the corporates that handle the hospitals.
Yes. In terms of the recovery of ashes and things, there's a presumption now that ashes will be recovered in every case, although there's a bit of...
My 30 years, I have never had a case where I didn't get ashes if I asked for them.
If you ask for them.
Now the code of practice means that every effort will be made to retain ashes, and if there isn't, the inspector crematoria will do an investigation as to why there wasn't any ashes.
And what circumstances could there possibly be that there wouldn't be a recovery of ashes, I suppose, as the... Yes, Tim, please.
Yeah, on a very rare occasion, it could be that a pregnancy loss of a very low gestational age that's perhaps cremated in a cardboard container, in some circumstances, although very rare, there might not be any ash in those circumstances. But certainly where a wooden coffin is used, there will always be ash.
Right, okay. Yes, Natalie?
From a crematorium perspective, we would indicate that all of our infant or NVF cremations have resulted in ash. And one of the things that I know that we've been discussing through the National Committee and the subgroups is all operators ensuring that we maximise the recovery, and that's certainly something that's been championed by Willie Reid in particular, and I know he gave evidence to this committee, so that all efforts of our operatives are in around maximising the recovery of those ashes, and that's certainly something that I know is happening across Scotland.
So it's happening now, and there's every expectation when they're requested, they'll be available. There's nothing to prevent that happening, other than what you've described, Willie, about the...
Very, 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 very rarely would there be ashes.
And did I read in the briefing, the evidence that was written, that there are other methods now being developed about... Yes, Tim?
Yeah, again, from the National Committee, there is operational guidance that's coming out of the committee that sets the conditions for cremation that are ideal for maximising the recovery of ashes.
Okay. And the bill specifies that ashes should exclude metal. Should the bill specify what should happen in these circumstances? Tim, you're on a run. I'll take others if they feel the need.
Yeah, the recovery of metal, although the definition of ashes says following the removal of metal, Lord Bonamy made the comment that doesn't preclude the recycling of that metal for charitable purposes.
Yeah.
At the present time, 60% of UK crematoria, and only 5 out of the 28 in Scotland, currently recycle metal recovered with the consent, with the specific consent of the applicant for cremation. At the present time, a scheme administered by the Institute in the last 12 months generated £700,000 for local charities, and those are charities nominated by the scheme member crematoria. Now, those 40% of UK crematoria and the 23 in Scotland that don't recycle are probably burying that metal within the grounds of the crematoria without consent. So the Institute feels that whatever the method of disposal of that metal, consent should be obtained from the applicant for cremation, and that would be from bereaved parents or adult cremations. In other words, all cremations consent for the disposal of that metal, and those applicants should be given the options available to them.
Okay. Any other comments? Anybody wish to add anything to Tim's response there? I think we've, in the main, covered, Nanette.
Ashes, because there seemed a little bit of disagreement about what's in the bill and what Lord Bonamy actually said. I just wondered what the view around the table was on that.
It has been agreed that it's been agreed and adopted by just about everyone that we would use the Lord Bonamy definition of the ashes as all that is left in the cremator after removal of metal.
Anything to add to that? And then I've got Caroline. Yep, Tim?
Whilst there's a need for the legal definition, if there could be some sort of explanatory note within the bill just stating that the legal definition contained in the bill and the definition made by Lord Bonamy are one and the same.
Yeah.
Okay. Caroline, do you wish to add?
Just, I was interested, NHS Lothian had endorsed the wording within the bill from the point of view of clarity, but I noticed some of the other written feedback asked the question about whether the grinding or cremulation part of the definition was required, and that may offend the sensibilities of certain faiths or cultural groups who wouldn't normally apply that process following cremation. And it just seemed a question about whether it would be necessary to include that, or whether to use the more simplified Bonamy definition of everything that's left without putting the cremulation part of the process into legislation within the definition of cremation and ashes.
Okay. I think we've covered all of the points at me, and I'm looking at you, Bob, I'm looking at some of the others. What I want to do, first of all, if you've got a wee point there that needs clarity, then we'll do that. Then I'll ask the panel members if there's any of the areas that they feel that we haven't covered this morning, and give them a last chance, and then we wrap it up. We've got the minister now, I think.
Yeah, and apologies to those given evidence. It wasn't a question I was going to ask, but I just spotted it from my briefings, and we should ask it for completeness for the evidence session, I think, convener. So obviously there's going to be a new criminal offence potentially created by negative instrument in relation to those who fail to meet their obligations under the terms of this new act. And that would be, looking at my briefing here, that would be punishable by a fine not exceeding level 3 on the standard scale. And I don't want to finish off on a negative note, because so much positive has come out of this, but I suppose it's only right to ask the question that if that negative instrument is passed, what those around this table think would be an appropriate sanction or fine or imprisonment or whatever, what the consequence should be for those who may be prosecuted. And let's hope they never are, because this system is already changing and will continue to improve further with the passage of this Act, but it is a potential provision within the bill, so it would be good to get something on record in relation to that, convener.
Tim?
Yeah, the level of punishment isn't something that really sort of springs to mind. I think I can only speak for crematoria, but anyone who willfully flouts the law deserves punishment. Fine apart, I think a person working in a crematorium losing their job for breaking the law would be more significant than a fine.
Natalie?
I think
The only thing I would say in relation to that is around the expectations of individuals who are affected by the services that we provide. One of the things in Edinburgh that we've been doing over the last few years is building trust and respect with those that we serve. And I think, you know, I won't necessarily comment on the nature of the sanction or the level of the sanction, but I think it affords those individuals a reassurance that that's a real legacy, that if in the future there was any wrongdoing, that appropriate action would be taken.
Nanette? Oh, sorry, Caroline first, and then we'll get a response, all the responses.
Sorry, it was just to say I have a general concern about those negative instruments, except insofar as they may apply to private burial, and we've said in the written response that there's a lack of definition perhaps around human remains within the bill, except that it excludes cremated remains, and also a lack of definition of pregnancy losses under 24 weeks. In some of those circumstances, for example, a medically managed early miscarriage or an early medical termination, it may be that the woman passes the pregnancy tissue at home, outside the hospital setting, and in those circumstances, you know, sometimes informal arrangements are made, which may in some circumstances include burying the tissue in private ground or under a tree or things like that happen. I want to sort of be sure whether or not the definition of human remains as it pertains to private burial would include pregnancy tissue, because that may have a sort of unintended consequence of bringing these sorts of informal private arrangements within an area of legislation where there is potentially a penalty or a year's imprisonment for not following the correct procedure to have that type of burial approved by the local authority.
The sort of criminality of new people breaching the law, is it right, do you think, that that is done by regulation, or should that be in the face of the bill? I think there was some concern about that from one of the committees.
Any views?
In my mind, so long as it's clearly articulated for those who are working in the industry what they're expected to perform in terms of their duties and also the consequences, I don't think City of Edinburgh Council would have a specific preference as to whether it was in the main legislation or by regulation.
Okay. Do any of the panel wish to say anything on the areas that maybe was not covered in the questions? Jim?
Briefly, because it's a huge area, we haven't even touched upon the regulation or licensing the funeral directors, which obviously is like trying to knit fog. Huge areas there. As I say, obviously, When I read the comments of the committee, I did notice that you had spotted that, you know, there's a lot of holes there. In defence of the government, because I say we've had a lot of conversations with the government regarding this, because it is such a complicated thing and so many different factors involved, they are looking at it in the way that we agree with, to look at as a whole over a period of time. To put it on the bill right here now would be virtually impossible. The only thing I can say is that the government seems to have taken the recommendations of Lord Bonamy as written in stone. And I would say there would be a slightly haste to meet all the recommendations as quickly as possible. There's a reason these laws haven't been looked at for 150 years, because they're extremely complicated and they affect so many different areas of Scotland, different traditions, different ideas. I'm wholeheartedly in favour of the bill. I say the fact that it has quite a few holes that can be addressed at a later period. But I say we really do need to have a chat with the powers that be about the licensing stroke regulation of funeral directors. Because I say there are many pro and against. That's all.
I think it is useful, Jim, if you've put that on the record. There is, as you well know, that there are more than one committee looking at this. And obviously there's a different focus from the local government committee in respect to some of this as well, and they have focused on some of these issues. If there's no one else, we want to... Yes, Natalie?
Sorry, just
one final comment, and it's more, I suppose, a thought for committee members in relation to the bill moving forward. One of the things that's been very clear in my mind that we need to continuously improve is the collaboration across different agencies who are supporting the bereaved at a very, very difficult time. And I wondered whether there was an opportunity to almost require you know, public agencies and statutory agencies to continue that collaboration in the future, because this is a fairly significant opportunity for us to revise the legislation. And I would really want to see the legacy from this as being part of us working together effectively in the future. So it's maybe just a thought for committee members.
That's useful. Tim?
Can I just endorse that? I think, yeah, it would be good for continuation even after the committees, the National Committee has finished its work, that collaboration continues. And from a cremation authority's point of view, the crematorium rarely sees a bereaved family before the funeral. So it does rely on, you know, that consistent information based on the, you know, the considerations by the crematoria, the funeral director, and the hospital. So consistent information, please.
Thanks for that. No one else. Can I thank you all for your time this morning and the evidence provided, both at this morning session and indeed the written evidence we've received. I hope we can reflect it in our final report. Thank you very much. We suspend at this point and set up for the minister. now move to the continuation of our evidence taking, and welcome to the committee Maureen Watt, Minister for Public Health. Welcome, Minister. Dr. Simon Cuthbert-Kerr, Burial and Cremation Bill Team Leader, and Graeme McGlashan, Principal Legal Officer, all from the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. Can I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks, and then we'll move to questions. Thanks, Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee today about the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. I'll focus my opening remarks on the part of the bill that this committee is considering. The bill contains a range of provisions which address the issues identified by Lord Bonamy to ensure that previous mistakes are not repeated. The bill provides a consistent legal process for the burial and cremation of all human remains, including those of a pregnancy loss. In the case of a pregnancy loss, the woman who has experienced the loss is placed at the centre of the decision-making process. The bill requires her requires that her options are explained to her and that she will have the sole right to make key decisions. Each key decision must be recorded, and the bill provides for forms to be prescribed so that the processes followed and the information recorded are the same each time. Excuse me. The bill will ensure a clear audit trail of decisions made and actions taken. Registers where the information is recorded will be open to the public, but in the case of pregnancy loss, the woman who experienced the loss will not be identifiable. These provisions will introduce important consistency and accountability. The bill also defines ashes, removing any uncertainty that what remains after a cremation will be regarded as ashes. People who apply for a cremation of any sort will be required to state on the application form what they want to happen to the ashes. A cremation will not be allowed to take place without this information. The bill also sets out what may be done with ashes which are not collected. While Lord Bonamy's work was concerned with infant cremation, we're taking the opportunity to make improvements to the cremation process generally. This will ensure that in every cremation there will be clarity about what is being done, what is expected, and what will happen to ashes. The bill delivers a strong package of measures that fully reform the legislative framework for cremation, making it fit for purpose for today's needs. This will implement Lord Bonamy's recommendations and make important changes to the processes involved in the cremation of pregnancy losses and babies, as well as bringing about improvements in the cremation process as a whole. And I look forward to the committee's questions.
Thank you, Minister. We move directly to Bob Doris.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. There's a lot of positive things that come out of our evidence session so far, but I hope you forgive me. I want to focus on what issues have been particularly raised where maybe the bill needs more clarity or may have to be improved. One of the things that was welcome was the fact that when tragedy happens and mums lose their baby, there's a 7-day period by which hospitals should within seek to try and establish what the wishes would be of mum, but after that, if no decision has been made, there's another 6 weeks by which mum has to make arrangements, as well as another 7 days on top of that where there can be a change of mind. Now, the bill says that after 6 weeks, there would be a duty to proceed in relation to the NHS in terms of how the baby's remains would be handled. After that, in evidence this morning, we got the idea that perhaps that shouldn't be a duty, perhaps that should be a right to proceed, because there could be reasons for why 6 weeks was not enough time to proceed and make very firm decisions in relation to that. Although the suggestion was made that it could be a duty to proceed unless there were stated reasons for why a decision could not be made by that time. I suppose what I'm getting at, Minister, is I'm just wondering if you've given consideration as to whether putting on the face of the bill a duty to proceed without caveating it somewhat is too firm, too set in stone, and there's maybe the need to be a bit more discretion and a bit more flexibility in relation to that.
Well, first of all, this is a very sensitive subject, and for anyone listening, you know, my heart goes out to some of the witnesses that you have already had. It's very sensitive, and we've been very careful in drafting this bill to consult widely, as you know, and all of it has been done with in conjunction with people who have been in this situation and bodies like SANS, charities like SANS, so that we have, as far as possible, I hope, reflected their concerns and their wishes. So in terms of, I think it's absolutely right that we put the woman at the heart of this. It's her loss. And, you know, it's a terribly traumatic time, and we have got to realise that a person may change their minds during that time. There may also be examinations that have to be done to the tissue or the fetus, and the 6 weeks was decided to be around about the right time. But of course we would expect health officials to deal very sensitively with it, and if further time was required, then, you know, that would be perfectly allowable.
Surely helpful, the convener there as well, considering about if it's a duty, it's, maybe consideration has to be given about how some NHS boards don't kick in automatically that duty after 6 weeks without that discretion and flexibility, which I'm delighted to hear that as Minister you would like to be sure about common sense to prevail at that point. So is that something you might consider on reflection?
Is to make sure that it is the length of time at 6 weeks and not less, so that, you know, a woman is given the right to change her mind if you know, after the initial trauma, she perhaps reflects and then decides that she would actually want to do something different with remains. So, you know, it's making sure that they have that length of time, 6 weeks. But if that's not enough, then we would expect the authorities to be sympathetic.
That's very helpful. A second issue that arose from evidence this morning was a welcoming about two clear options in relation to how hospitals would seek to support a mum who's maybe lost their unborn child, in relation to that choice they have about whether or not to deal privately with how they would handle that, or whether the NHS would make arrangements. Quite often they would be group arrangements in relation to how the babies were handled and dealt with in relation to those tragic circumstances. But we heard from NHS Lothian that just now they're a little bit more nuanced in relation to that, and they're actually very supportive in relation to supporting mums, supporting families, having maybe bespoke private arrangements, but not left to their own devices to go and do that themselves, but the NHS provides support in relation to that. So again, it's just to make sure that the bill doesn't lead to unintended consequences. So both those options of the NHS taking care of that matter at a time of distress, if that's what mum wants, or mum going off privately and arranging something, but the spectrum in between that, where NHS boards can sensitively help and support. I would just want to make sure that this bill doesn't squeeze out what could be best practice or might be emerging best practice in NHS Lothian, and I would hope in other NHS boards across the country as well.
I hope the bill, I'm open to, obviously, to other suggestions, but I think it does set out the options available for a woman, and, you know, there will be those who choose to take the remains and dispose of them privately through a funeral director. And I think you've heard that funeral directors in the main are very experienced, well, not very experienced, but experienced in dealing with this situation too. So I think it is important that post the event that women have the chance to talk and reflect with midwives or the doctors and pastors, you know, hospital chaplains, and, you know, as I say, up to 6 weeks have that flexibility to choose themselves what they want to do.
My final question, because I know other members will want to come in and ask more questions, but it's just, I suppose, that NHS Lothian, perhaps others, were just seeking the reassurance that the legislation doesn't preclude them from providing additional support to mums that have lost their babies. And I see Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr agreeing that that's not the intention. But it's just to get some of that on the record to reassure the NHS, which is, you've now got the opportunity to do, Minister.
If Simon is nodding, I'll let him answer this one. Yeah, yes. But yes.
Thanks, Minister. I think that's absolutely right. As the Minister says, the key to the bill is to allow the flexibility of approaches. It's a reality, I think, that not all health boards necessarily have the same procedures in place as NHS Lothian do. However, nothing in the bill would prevent a health board from offering that sort of situation that you describe, whereby essentially there is a private cremation carried out, but the family is supported in doing that by the health board. And we very much would expect all health boards, when they begin to discuss the options with the woman who's experienced the loss, to explain to her the various options that are open to her and what they all mean.
And there is Chief Medical Officer guidelines and advice, and that is updated, has been updated regularly, and of course will be updated again as a result of this bill.
Thank you.
The point was raised by Lothian, who, if you like, are doing a lot of good work in this area, that duty that was being placed on them doesn't give them that flexibility. So it's not, you know, it comes from Lothian, who feel that is a duty in the bill that they must act upon at that 6 weeks point. The other issues that have been raised in evidence is the early stage as well, with the 7 day and time to reflect and whatever. There are some issues that come out of that in terms of religious and cultural beliefs that would impact on that as well, and that, you know, applying the standard would be best served by some flexibility in and around that as well.
I think we are very mindful of that, and I think in the guidance the flexibility will be inbuilt. You know, there are, I've, you know, Simon and I were talking recently about, you know, we now live in a multicultural society, and as you said, convener, some faiths will want to dispose of remains as quickly as possible, and we're mindful of that. And in drawing up the guidance and the forms, we have and will continue to consult widely.
So that would be addressed in the forums, but the bill would say that there's a requirement to.
I think we should look at this. You know, I think most people want to have people buried as quickly as possible, but the 6 weeks gives the woman who's at the centre of this the flexibility to, because of the trauma of the situation, reflect and have that time to decide what to do. But I don't think anybody would want to drag the process out unnecessarily.
Mm. But the earlier stage, you know, that places a duty on everybody to wait until, what is it, 7 days after the decisions to reflect and whether that decision is what they really want. So there's I think it was described, it's not very apt, but it's a cooling off period almost for 7 days, which would impact on those religious or cultural practices that would require a disposal, you know, or a ceremony very, very quickly, which would apply to everyone then, would it not, in the legislation?
I mean, it's not set in stone that you must wait 7 days. If Well, Simon, do you want to answer this?
Okay, thanks, Minister. I mean, the reason for the seven-day period is really in response to engagement we've had with pregnancy loss charities like SANS, who the Minister mentioned earlier, and others, where their experience is often that a woman may make a decision about how she wants the remains to be handled, but then, having reflected on it, may choose to make a different decision. So we felt that it was important that there was a period whereby nothing would happen, and that would allow the woman to change her mind. However, we've subsequently had representation from the likes of the Muslim Council of Scotland, who have noted that that would potentially prevent a burial or a cremation, well, burial in that case, taking place sooner rather than later. So we're now going to consider a stage two amendment so that a woman, for whatever reason, whether that's a religious belief, a cultural belief, or simply just because she's clear in her own mind that she knows what's going to happen, can waive that seven-day period.
That's very helpful. We heard this morning that in these cases, that a woman who's suffering a pregnancy loss will be in that hospital environment maybe for 24 or 48 hours, 1 or 2 days. We know that there's one midwife in the whole of Scotland who's got some training here. And the Minister placed some responsibility on that bereavement process on the basis of doctors, maybe nurses, or hospital pastors. Now, that's all going to, that's all, you know, the success of this is about good communication. You know, are we confident that we've got the capacity to deal with this, that we've got the people in place, the training, the expertise, and if not, how are we going to practically implement this to make a difference to people who are suffering a pregnancy loss in the future?
In all cases, Convener, we can always do better, but this is ongoing at the moment, and I'm not aware of any complaints about what happens at the moment. So I think, you know, as I said, we can always do better, and the training is already there in the hospital setting, and obviously a woman will be discharged to her own GP practice, and they will be aware of the situation and will be able to follow up.
Yeah, I think maybe some of the others might want to refer to it, but I mean, I think when we had an engagement with women parents who had suffered this loss, they describe experiences in a busy maternity ward. Nanette, can you describe some of this?
I think it was. I was going to ask a question, but the application forms anyway. But in relation to basically filling up the forms, some of the bereaved parents had felt that, you know, they had lost, had a stillbirth or whatever, and then they were presented by a member of staff with the form, asked various questions, and that the form was essentially filled up for them, and they really hadn't any real idea what they'd signed up to. They felt the process was a little bit rushed, and some of them felt that there should perhaps be sort of counselling at that stage where someone had the time to sit down and think, I appreciate in a busy maternity ward, midwives don't really have time. They might be dealing with a bereaved parent and then rushing to do a delivery. And I can see how these situations could arise. And there was a concern expressed at that point in time, and when it came to actually filling up some of these fairly complicated forms. And I have other questions about forms, if I may later.
I think, you know, in other situations we hear of funeral directors filling in forms for bereaved relatives without necessarily really delving into what the form and the questions actually means. And we want to make sure that the forms are as streamlined as possible and have sections for specifically where a child is involved and specifically where an adult is involved. You know, I think the fact that we'll have this period of delay will mean that if the form's filled in, if women feel that it's filled in a rush, that they can ask to go to back over it. But there will be CMO, there is CMO guidance and will be further CMO guidance on this particular part of a death.
How, final question and move to colleagues. How many women will benefit from this legislation? I suppose what I'm asking is how many people currently find themselves in a situation pre-24 weeks right through suffering, in the broadest term, pregnancy loss.
Have you got the figures, son? I can certainly give you the figures of pregnancy loss and stillbirth figures. They are out there. It is declining, and I'm currently having a review of infant mortality and maternal health, maternity review. So that will also help with that. But the CMO is very, as you know, experienced in this area, and we're determined to get the numbers down still further. But in terms of how many people are affected, we can certainly get you those figures.
The reason I'm asking that question is because, to pass the legislation places a lot of requirements on a lot of different organisations, including record keeping, counselling, whatever. There's a creating that demand there and an expectation that people will be communicated effectively with, their wishes will be respected. If we don't know the actual number of women who need to be have access to that type of new regime, then how do we understand the resources that we need to make it effective?
It's building on, it's not a new regime. I mean, there are regimes in place at the moment. As I've said, there is CMO guidance at the moment. But what we want to do, I mean, this is the result of Lord Bonamy's report and the baby ashes scandal. So what we want to make sure is that the process reflects what happened there and make sure that it never happens again.
Richard Lyle.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Can we return to the fact that the bill explains that a single application form will be used to record all applications for a cremation, including any cremations of remains from pregnancy, loss, stillborn, or loss of a baby? We've had evidence from several people that it would be preferred to have rather than one form. Now, one form, to me, a single application form is an A5 piece of paper. Just A4, sorry, piece of paper. Put in any, all, and everything. Could be death. You know, we've all experienced death during our lives and also births. And basically, to have a single form, which could be actually expand to a booklet, it won't become a single form then, is a situation where we could be asking questions of people who have sadly experienced in their past life, while they're burying their husband, may have experienced a pregnancy loss many years ago, and going through that form with anyone will traumatise them. So why aren't we suggesting, or why aren't we going down the situation of having three separate forms? It's been suggested by NHS Lothian. They've raised concerns about the single form, and the Institute of Cemetery and Crematorium have raised concerns about a single form, and basically they're suggesting it would be three forms, one for infants, stillbirths, pre 24 weeks, stillbirths and pregnancy losses. So are we considering changing, or what was your original perception of just one form? To encapsulate everything.
In terms of the form, it's not been decided yet what the form will look like or what it will, how long it will be. That will be decided in consultation with organisations and health boards and funeral directors. But you can rest assured, Mr. Lyle, that we want to keep it as sensitive and as precise as we possibly can, but yet make sure that we have enough to keep accurate records and consistent records, and that there's, as I say, consistency across Scotland, which I don't think there is at the moment.
Do you know that actually some crematorium have introduced their own forum, which could be wide-ranging all over the number of crematoria in Scotland?
Yeah, and that's why we want to get consistency of the forms so that every organisation is using the same form.
Okay. I have other questions, convener, but I know other members may want to ask these questions. I'll leave it until the end.
Yeah. No opportunity to come back in. Yeah. Rhoda Grant, followed by Nanette.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask some questions around confidentiality, especially post 24 weeks for stillbirth and the like? The bill seems not to afford the same levels of confidentiality as was previously the case, and I'm wondering if the Minister's given any thought to that, especially with regard to late terminations.
Yes, there's already a guidance on this, and post 24 weeks is regarded as a stillbirth and has to be recorded, whereas pre 23 weeks, 6 days, it hasn't to, doesn't have to be recorded. But the forms will make sure that the person is not identifiable.
And that's in all cases, the person wouldn't be identifiable. Okay. Can I also ask about arrangements for, it states in the bill that the person who makes arrangements must be 16 years or over. What regard is taken of a mother who is under 16 and her wishes in regards with regard to disposal?
Well, that again is a very sensitive situation, but we would hope that either a very close relative would be involved, or if the under 16 does not want relatives to be involved, that the health board, the NHS service would provide that.
That doesn't seem to be in the legislation.
We can check, but we have said generally that if a woman doesn't want relatives to be involved, that's her wish and that should be respected, and that the NHS should provide the service.
Okay, I maybe need to look at that again, because to my view, for people younger than 16, that wasn't the case.
Thank you. Nanette.
My questions about the forms, I think, have been answered already. But the really, to go on to the meaning and treatment of ashes, the definition in the bill of ashes differs slightly from Lord Bonamy's definition. And asking the previous panel about it, they felt that the definition of the bill, fine, but perhaps should be clarified by Lord Bonamy's definition as well, just for absolute clarity. And there was also a thought as to whether the means of grinding or whatever means of dealing with ashes, whether that needed necessarily to be in the bill, might upset some people.
Yes, it is a very sensitive area, and I did visit a crematoria so that I was a crematorium so that I knew what exactly happened. Sorry, I've lost the thread of your question again.
Well, it really was the definition within the...
Of ashes, yes, and Lord Bonamy. Yes. I think among the stakeholders, it was kind of thought that the definition of ashes in Lord Bonamy's report wasn't quite what they expected, and that's why we've redefined it. I think this is with the agreement of the stakeholders. And in terms of in the crematorium, I mean, there is the idea that there'll be baby ashes, separate trays in a crematorium, or you can opt to have a completely separate cremation in a small cremator. So these options are available for people and should be explained to them what the options are.
I think the connection to that, the other thing was the actual fact of ashes being available. And I think the people around the table this morning said the very vast majority of cases there would be recoverable ashes. It'd be very, very rare for there not to be. And I think that was sort of accepted. The other thing was the both definitions obviously exclude metal within remains. And it was really what should happen to that metal thereafter. And I honestly can't remember if it's defined in the bill what should happen to it or not, but I welcome the thoughts on that.
Yeah, metal can be separately taken out of the ashes. And I think in your previous session, somebody said that there was £700,000 worth of metal recovered. I don't know what over what period that is, but clearly, if that is the case, and there is a good use to which that could be put to, maybe even in terms of counselling and things, counselling charities, that sounds like a good idea, which we'll definitely take away after this morning's session and have a look at.
Okay. Much more later.
Can you follow up on that, Bob? Yes.
Sorry, just very specifically, I think this morning's session, that was a really interesting idea. It seemed a really positive thing. But one of the things that also came out in relation to the recovery of metal, if it's not deemed to be part of the ashes themselves, is still about relatives giving authority for how that metal is or isn't used, or to be informed that metal was recovered and they would intend to dispose of it, and here's how, and signing up to that within the process. So it's just whether the government give consideration as to whether on the face of the bill or in regulations, best practice by statute or otherwise, would be considered about how the cremation authority or the funeral directors, whoever that would fall with, would make sure that families knew what was happening, because the metal could be keepsakes that were within the coffin when loved ones were being cremated, so maybe they might want some of that back, or they may be keen to have it buried in a garden of remembrance, or they might sign up to a recovery scheme. But it's about empowering the families to have a choice in that matter. And it's just, and I think this goes wider probably than infants and babies, so whether it would be considered elsewhere rather as part of this bill, I don't know, but it definitely has to be considered, I would say, Minister.
Yes, and this is one of the things that will be, there'll be a question on the form, so you can already see the forms getting larger when you take into account things like this. So, yes, this will definitely be a question on the forms.
I suppose the only other one that we have in the brief in this ever longer forum, should the bill specify how crematoria should dispose of ashes that are unclaimed?
This is a big problem, and certainly when I visited Seafield Crematoria, I was taken to a room where there were urns unclaimed, and yes, the bill will specify what crematoria or funeral directors should do with ashes if they remain unclaimed. We would expect them to be taken back to a crematoria, and crematoria would dispose of ashes periodically. But in all cases, we would still try to contact the relatives, and I think that's an ongoing thing at the moment and will continue to be with crematoria and funeral directors. But sometimes you can understand people just not wanting, but they should be able to say that and let the crematoria or the funeral directors deal sensitively with them after having kept them for a while.
Members who have not asked a question wish to ask a question at this point? I'll return to Richard Lyle.
Can I ask? And most of the questions I was going to ask have been answered. There was a suggestion made in my experience of burying loved ones. I've come across some wonderful undertakers who have been very sensitive and very working with the family. What position is the government looking at in regards to licensing of undertakers? And also, can I, the other question I want to ask is, if someone knowingly breaks the law, what can the courts or anyone do in order to take that person to court?
I think we do want to regulate more the funeral industry. I think there are increasing concerns about the funeral industry and people thinking that's an easy thing to do, to just set up being an undertaker. It's clearly not. And so the bill will give the minister powers to regulate the industry. And I think that's something that, you know, I would consider in relation to the communities minister as well and the whole cost now of funerals. But costs are not dealt with in this bill. It's not appropriate that they're dealt with in this bill, but it is some work that Alec Neil's taking on as well. And, you know, we've all seen the Citizens Advice Scotland's cost of dying report. So it's clearly something that is to the forefront at the moment.
I won't get into the costs of funerals, but we know they are very expensive. One of the other points that's been made by several witness in particular was the fact that, you know, we're going to have an inspector who'll go out, but basically, would that person have any someone to help them if they wanted particular, you know, there's so many crematoria, I think it's 24 or more in Scotland. Basically, would it just be a one-man band or one-person band, or alternative, would they be able to have appointees, like as used to be prison visitors used to be appointed by local agencies, and basically what, again, can that the inspector fine or recommend somebody to be fined if they find that they have broken the law or have broken the new laws that are coming in?
In terms of the inspectors, we have clearly one inspector at the moment, but the bill will allow the appointment, me or my any subsequent ministers of public health to appoint as many inspectors as required. I hope that we wouldn't have a situation where we needed a whole lot of inspectors, but maybe one is not enough. You know, we'll certainly make sure that people feel confident that crematoria are all working well and to a good standard. In terms of penalties, Simon, do you want to take that one?
Okay, thanks, Minister. I suppose there are two different approaches. The bill sets out a range of specific offences which attract particular penalties if those are breached. An inspector could report that breach, or an individual member of the public could report that breach. So there's various routes whereby those formal penalties can come into force. More generally, however, we would see the role of the inspector very much to be to ensure that whatever business or organisation he or she was inspecting was doing what was expected of them. We intend, and it's set out in sections in the bill which talk about the inspector's powers, we would expect that would range from providing advice to a particular crematorium, for example, about how to come into compliance with the law, through to recommending to ministers that operation of that particular crematorium was suspended. That's a decision that would be taken by ministers, but we certainly would view that as being one of the options an inspector could recommend.
Bob Doris.
Thanks, Convener. I want to ask a little bit more about how we deal with pregnancy loss before 24 weeks. And of course, there's various distinctions that kick in terms of timescale and terminology. So where the word fetus is used, it could be implied that it's a pregnancy that ends 8 weeks or earlier. 11 weeks also kicks in at a certain point within the bill as well. Maybe by that point you're booked in for your 12-week scan, and how a pregnancy loss is dealt with by midwives and specialists would kick in at that point also. So I'm just wondering whether thought has been given or further thought to be given to the very early miscarriages or pregnancies that end where maybe mum's told that the pregnancy is likely to be unsuccessful, it's still at very early stages, go home, go through what you have to go through for that to happen. Maybe baby's remains is at home. Maybe mum has to go to accident and emergency, because that doesn't always go to plan either. And at that point, you're dealt with non-specialists within the wider NHS who clearly try to do as good and sensitive a job as they possibly can, but they may not see these things very often. And is at what point would options be given there for how would you like your unborn child or your fetus, the terminology becomes really quite important emotionally in these situations, how would you like that to be dealt with sensitively? Is there standard and common practice across the NHS, or should this bill act as a focus to improve how we deal with these situations, perhaps the non-specialist side of NHS care for the very early of earliest of pregnancies that end in miscarriage?
It is our intention, having studied the bill further and had more consultation, that the bill should apply to embryos, and we will lodge a stage 2 amendment to make this clear. It is obviously up section, I think 50 brackets 2 brackets A, does say that a woman may decide to make her own arrangements for the disposal of remains rather than authorising an individual or the health authority to make those arrangements, and the woman would be given the guidance on what she should she can do if she wants to make her own arrangements. There is CMO guidance on pregnancy losses up to and including 23 weeks and 6 days, recognising that the woman already has the right to make personal arrangements, so it is possible currently for a woman to make their own arrangements for the disposal of those remains. But the bill will formalise that process and provide additional clarity and consistency.
Much welcome that. I'm just wondering, as part of that question there, and that's very reassuring, that that can and does happen in practice, but it might not happen consistently across the NHS at the moment, or maybe has never, actually not at the moment, has never been done consistently across the NHS. So it's about driving up standards, and it's back to that thing again about a lot of frontline NHS workers may very, very rarely and occasionally come face to face with a mum who's maybe recurrent miscarriage, pregnancy loss, and turns up at hospital. So I suppose the key part of the question was, will those provisions be taken? And you've signalled that will happen via an amendment. I really welcome that. But I suppose it's also about how we do that wider awareness training for non-specialists within the NHS. Is that something that you would give consideration to as well?
I caution against saying that there isn't consistency at the moment, because there are clear CMO guidelines out there already, and obviously there'll be new CMO guidelines taking into account the provisions of this bill once they come into operation. And obviously health boards have a duty to make sure that all those involved in this area are aware and have training in any CMO guidelines.
Yeah, but apologies, Minister, just for clarity from my question, I'm not stating how significant consistency or inconsistency is within the NHS. I'm merely saying that there's an opportunity to ensure that there's consistency, because in any huge organisation, by definition, there will be individual experiences where people will not be dealt with sensitively. That's just the nature of any huge organisation. And it's about driving up standards and constituency, even when things are working reasonably well. So the question was actually, will you use this bill as an opportunity to make sure that there is consistency and that those NHS workers on the front line who may not see this every day are made aware of what their duties and responsibilities are in a supportive fashion, of course.
An implementation programme, and obviously training very much part of that implementation programme.
Thank you.
To pick up on that and take, you know, the ambition for this other bill to regulate, to keep records, to monitor, who monitors the output of the guidelines that are currently in place, and when do we last evaluate whether those guidelines were being implemented consistently?
I think at the moment, particularly in terms of NHS records, there's not necessarily any external scrutiny of that. So we would see that as being one of the roles for the inspectors. I guess in the case of pregnancy loss, for example, we would look to perhaps the inspector of crematoria, or perhaps burial, depending on what route the particular pregnancy loss has gone. There's clearly some data protection issues there. We would need to make sure that an external inspector was able to inspect records to the extent that they were able to satisfy themselves that things were being done properly, or to make recommendations where they weren't being done properly, while at the same time protecting the confidentiality of individuals whose records are being scrutinised. So that's one of the functions we would view for the inspector.
I suppose I'm trying to get at one or two points here. In terms of the CMO guidelines that have been referred to by the Minister, who evaluates those now? How do we know that those CMO guidelines are being implemented are effective at this current time?
The CMO herself would make sure that she currently monitors the guidelines in conjunction with people in the health boards themselves. So
they're not independently assessed, inspected, evaluated.
Not that I'm aware of, but we can certainly let you know in terms of that.
Minister, if we're moving to another regime that expects all of these, I suppose what we're talking about here is what is applied in regulation and what's in the face of the bill and what becomes a legal duty. So how are we going to ensure, if we don't put some of these measures into regulation or make them legal duties, that they will improve, to use a less pejorative, they will establish and improve best practice as a result of this legislation? Who will monitor it? Who will inspect it? Who will tell us when it's going wrong? And who will tell us when it's going well?
This is very much part of the duties of the inspectors of crematoria in to making sure that in relation to burial and cremation that best practices are implemented.
Yeah. I was particularly thinking about, you know, the situations in hospitals that ensure that discussion takes place, that discussion has taken place, that discussion has been registered, the persons, you know, who will ensure that all of this actually takes place?
We have, at the moment, for example, if anybody's not happy with a situation, there's a complaints procedure that they can go through. It's often, things like this are often flagged up on patient opinion, and they can go to the SPSO.
But Minister, we're dealing with this legislation because people went through a traumatic experience, mm-hmm. who so traumatic that they couldn't or didn't have the will, confidence or whatever, to ensure that what was in place, you know, their wishes would be respected. So, you know, to say that, well, they can complain and that the complaint will trigger a failure in the system is pretty, you know, well, how do we prevent failure in the first place is more important. That's what the legislation is about, is it not?
Yes, and that's why, you know, there will be guidance as a result of this bill, and the inspector his job is to make sure that that is adhered to.
I was thinking mainly about the situation that develops in our hospital. When the event happens, who will ensure that the discussion took place? Who will ensure that the midwife engaged or the designated person engaged?
Maybe we're straying on to another of my bills that's currently going through the Parliament in terms of duty of candour.
We've discussed issues about that situation, you know, arising in hospitals.
It'll be for the inspector to do that in hospitals.
The inspector would... The crematorium inspector would have a right to inspect the processes within the NHS, is that what was
the
said?
Process in relation to the disposition of remains of children and ashes. And yes, do you want to say anything?
I think we would view the whole process as being part of the same process. So from the point of the loss through to either burial or cremation, we would see that as a continuation of a single process. I think, therefore, it's valid for the inspector of crematorium or inspector of burial to be able to have the power to go to a sort of hospital and review their practices. Now, that might not be something they do in isolation. It may be something that they do with quality assurance staff in a particular NHS board. But we're viewing this as part of the process, not as two separate processes whereby a pregnancy loss occurs, a separate process happens in the hospital, and then a second process takes over for the particular disposal. I realise I'm repeating myself, but we're very much viewing it as a single process from the point at which the loss occurs through to the point at which, excuse me, the disposal happens, and that's a process which will happen in different contexts, both hospitals and crematoriums and burial grounds, and we'll bring into play various different professionals, including crematorium staff, burial ground staff, and of course hospital staff. So we think it's absolutely valid that the inspector has a role.
Responsibility in deciding whether...
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch that.
The crematorium inspector will have the ultimate responsibility to pass judgment on whether a given hospital... he will have access to those records.
As I said in my previous answer, I think we would expect the inspector to have access to the records in order to establish that processes were being done properly under the terms of this Act. He or she won't necessarily be a medical practitioner, so parts of that record might have to be redacted. But it would be about ensuring that the process was taking place properly, so that, you know, working backwards, so that forms were being completed properly, so that the options open to the women were being explained properly, so that timescales were being adhered to.
Test that against people's experience. We'd be speaking to those people who have suffered the loss to check that they were satisfied, that they were given an opportunity to...
I mean, that's not necessarily one thing we've looked at the inspector doing. We've viewed very much the inspector as being looking at the process, but I don't think that there's anything in the bill that would prevent he or she from doing that. In fact, we know that the current inspector has spoken to individual members of the public about the experience of cremation, mm-hmm. not necessarily in the context of pregnancy loss.
We heard in the evidence that's a new experience. Mm. Because it's not typical that somebody running a crematorium or, you know, we'd be engaging, you know, at all with the public. That's done by funeral directors or doctors or whatever down
Indeed.
The line. But it's an interesting idea suppose the evaluation. How do we get, you know, how do we know that we're making a difference with all this form filling and doing all of that if we don't speak to people who've been through the system to assess whether they felt involved, that they were empowered to make decisions and choices, and that their choices were carried out and they were satisfied with the services.
Most people who have been in hospital are given the opportunity to feedback their experience if they so wish.
Yeah. There's an experience they give in the hospital and there's an experience that they give to you and I as MSPs, Minister. Sometimes a difference, but anyway. Bob, yes, Nanette, I'll bring you in.
I suppose, sorry, Nanette, it's on the same theme. I'm just wondering if much of this is already inspected. We just don't particularly tie it together. So where I've got the new inspector at post being is looking at individual cases and following it through every step of that process. So when it's an individual case, following it through to whether mum's turned up at an A&E unit in significant pain, all the way through to whether there's a cremation or not, and that's a process been fed through, and this is a new post that can look through that where problems arise or there's not ashes recovered, that kind of thing. So I think I'm clearing my head, convener, in relation to that. But separate from that, accident and emergency units get reviewed and assessed. There's currently, and I apologise if it's now completed and I've missed the conclusion of it, but there was a review of maternity services in Scotland. I don't know if that's ongoing or complete. I would imagine that would look at this kind of thing as part of the maternity services review. Individual maternity units also get assessed for how they're doing. So there's lots of different inspection regimes at play in the NHS at the one time. I suppose what I would want assurance on is that when all these inspections are kicking in, that they're given cognizance as part of those reviews going forward, once we've got this piece of legislation on the statute, to making sure any future maternity review or individual maternity units or when A&Es are assessed, the whole gambit of services in the NHS, where appropriate, that we also, as part of that, assess to make sure we're getting obligations within this bill correct. I suppose that would be my question.
Yes, and I mean, we must stick to the fact that this is a Burials and Cremation Scotland bill, so we're actually talking about women specifically in this situation. And obviously, what we're trying to do in this bill is make sure that the baby ashes scandal never happens again, and that we have legislation in statute as far as possible, having consulted all the people that we possibly can in relation to this. And I think stakeholders, very much in the majority, are in favour of what is being proposed in this bill.
I think I would agree with that. Convener, just finally, Nanette, I really apologise, but it's just in case we see any hairs running today in relation to going back to bereaved parents who can be incredibly vulnerable and may or may not wish to be contacted again. How can you ever know that? Because we heard in last week's evidence as well that the issue around some parents may want that, some parents may not want that. The risk of re-traumatisation, part of the baby's ashes scandal, was parents who had sought to deal with, move on. However, anyone can deal with and move on in these situations, been re-traumatised by reading in the papers this scandal in itself. So just a slight concern that if we ever were to go back at a later date to an impacted parent about how we could ever do that in a way that didn't. I'm not saying we shouldn't, but I just don't think we could get an answer to it. Last week's evidence about how we could do that in a way that wouldn't risk further emotional impact and distress, and that whether parents themselves as a group would even have a view in relation to that.
I think things have moved on greatly, and I think any person who finds themselves in this situation is signposted to counselling services that are available. I wouldn't think we would actively seek people out.
Thank
but,
you
know, through the media, you often ask people if they want to come forward.
Yeah. Thank you.
Nanette, then Colin.
One or two questions on the keeping of registers of cremations and burials. I noticed the bill says that ministers can, by negative instrument, make it an offence if health authorities, crematoria or burial authorities fail to keep their registers in the form specified. And I know that this fact that this is done by regulation rather than on the bill has been criticised by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, so maybe a bit of clarity on that. But what behaviour is likely to result in a criminal offence, you know, in relation to registers being kept by health authorities, cremation and burial authorities?
So generally, we don't see any particular problems with the register. There are other registers like birth deaths registers, and they're already public documents. And we don't see there any reasons why the registers shouldn't be made public under the bill. There are obviously data protection issues to consider. So in the case of a pregnancy loss, the public register will, as I said previously, will not identify the woman experiencing the loss. In that case, a unique identifying number would be used. So I think it's about having an audit trail without revealing the identity of the woman. I think there was some concern that that the registers might be used, for example, by debt recovery companies to attempt to trace money owned by the deceased. I don't think that's going to be a big problem because there are obviously currently other ways that people can get that source of information. I don't know, Simon, do you want to add anything?
Thank you, Minister. In terms of what would constitute an offence in terms of registers, the bill talks about failing to prepare or maintain a register as prescribed. So essentially that would be things like either not having a register at all or failing to record the information in the manner that was prescribed, either the wrong information, incomplete information, or in the wrong format.
What's the reason for not having that in the face of the bill and having it in regulation instead?
Well, we have taken into account what the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have said, and we're looking to bring forward at stage two any amendments where we can specifically bring that onto the face of the bill.
Minister, I think the offences that the member's talking about are actually on the face of the bill already in sections 11 and 42, so they're not left to regulations, they are actually offences set out on the face of the bill in relation to the register.
Familiar with the other parts of the bill?
There are others, and we are reviewing those in light of the DPLRC's reports with a view to rationalising them.
Okay, and the final thing really is, should there be a specification that these records should be kept in electronic form, given that we're in the 21st century, or not?
We haven't specified that. I think we would like to get to that point, obviously, but different organisations are at different stages of computerisation, so we didn't want to force costs on crematoria or undertakers, but we obviously would like to get to that situation.
Thanks. It was good to hear from Mr. McGlashan. That we've heard some information earlier today about the various legislation that's in this field, and I think we've heard from the Minister in terms of the register of births and legal requirements, particularly in regard to over 24 weeks and 5 or 6 days, that there's a requirement to register that birth. Is that correct? So just to get clarity on the early assurances from the Minister about the anonymous nature of that will that apply to all births over 24 weeks or just the terminations? That they don't need to be.
My understanding was that all stillbirths, well,
currently stillbirths are recorded.
Currently stillbirths are recorded and the name is listed over 24 weeks.
Pardon? I don't know where the sound is. Can we put the.
Sorry. Currently, sorry.
That was me, honestly.
Okay.
A bit lower, so yes, please.
So currently, stillbirths over 24 weeks are recorded, and the name is recorded as well.
Yes,
and that will continue.
We'll look at it, but we think so. Yes.
Yes, that part, but terminations at 24 weeks.
I think we'll need to look at that.
As a question about whether you can provide that.
it's still
privacy and
Simon, do you want to come in? I think it's still considered as a
absolutely, Minister. It's not. I have to say, it's not something we've particularly considered. The distinction between 23 weeks and 6 days and 24 weeks is set out in the birth deaths and registration of birth deaths and marriages Act Scotland 1965. So we've essentially taken forward the bill on that basis. So our understanding is that any pregnancy which is delivered beyond 24 weeks and is dead, regardless of how that has come about, is legally registered as a stillbirth, which is then registered as a stillbirth and records the name of the mother. We certainly could look at that to see whether we could bring about anything so that in particular circumstances the mother's anonymity is
raised with us in evidence in terms of late terminations where there may be an issue there about which that mother may wish or require some anonymity. So that was when it was raised with us. The other I think beyond that was the requirement, the legal requirement to register that birth after 24 weeks, which is law, abortion law, and this, you know, do we see, you know, we've had some evidence that there's a lot of law in this area which might be conflicting at this point in terms of the aims of the bill. Is that something that you have examined? I'm looking at the legal advice, Minister.
Certainly, the members about where abortion laws reserved at the minute, so we can't operate on anything that's currently in the 1967 Act. In relation to what's recorded, we are sort of taking on the current position with stillbirths that's in place at the minute in the 1965 Act. I mean, we can certainly go away and reflect on the evidence that you've heard earlier and have a think further, but there's certainly legislative competence limits on what we, as a Parliament, we can do in terms of the Abortion Act at the minute.
But I suppose with the general question, if you were wish to consider or take on board the issue of late terminations after the 24 weeks, currently, after 24 weeks, irrespective of the death, that would need to be registered as a stillbirth.
That's the current position.
You know, how much flexibility have you got there? Would that mean that the 65 Act regarding the register would need to be amended to allow you to do something different there?
I mean, I can certainly go away and reflect on it. You'll appreciate they're complex issues and I haven't been presented with this issue about late termination.
That's fine. It's something that's came out of evidence. We're not arguing one way or the other. It's just an issue.
Terminations after 24 weeks would be for medical reasons only.
Yes, we understand that. Yeah. But whether...
Right. Then we're going into hypothetical and suppositions.
Well, it's all hypothetical until it happens.
Yes, please. Thanks, Convener. I just think for clarity for myself here, some understanding is because of the reserved nature of some of the legislation, the current practice in terms of how stillbirths are registered, irrespective of whether it's a post 24 week termination or a pregnancy that didn't make it to full term, that will stay the same. This bill doesn't change that. I, for my part, wouldn't like to enter discussion about whether we should change that. As a whole other discussion and a whole other area about whether stillbirth should be registered after 24 weeks via a termination. I think maybe the substantial issue for this committee might be the anonymity of those who have the termination. I think that takes the other aspect of the discussion out of the equation. So currently, does post 24 weeks... individuals who have a termination, do they have that right to privacy and anonymity, and will this bill change any of that? I think that's the substantive point for my interest, rather than whether it should be registered or not, because that takes us to a whole other discussion, I would think.
As Simon said, at the moment, a stillbirth, where there is a stillbirth after 24 weeks the person is normally named in the bill. But we'll go away and have a look at it.
We've got a bit of clarity in terms of where there is a confidentiality and where there isn't, and we might take further consideration on that ourselves. And it's just that it's a theme that started to emerge, not whether they should be registered or not. I think that's a whole other discussion. Yeah.
I think Bob's hit on a point, but there are aspects of this bill about notifying the nearest relative, etc., etc. So I suppose it's more about that aspect there about confidentiality, should that person want it, whether this bill changes that relationship. The other one, we've spoke a lot about these situations arising in the hospital setup, not always the case, as Bob pointed out, in accident emergency and other aspects, but out with the hospital, I suppose, there was an issue raised in evidence about pregnancy loss happening outside the hospital, in prison, a residential setting, or indeed at home, I suppose. And have we given that any consideration about?
Pregnancy loss occurs in a prison, the health authority will be involved, because as of 2011 the care of prisoners became the responsibility of the NHS, so a prisoner would receive medical care throughout the pregnancy, just like anybody else, from the NHS. In terms of residential care, again it would be provided by the NHS board.
So there would be somebody who would engage with that woman, who would take on that role. I mean, the role's clearly defined in a hospital setting, but there would be a designated person who would take on that role of dealing with that woman from the health service or the local government.
I wouldn't see any discrimination between the care of a pregnant woman, regardless of the setting.
Regardless of the setting. There would be someone designated from the health board or local authority to inform that woman of her options and choices.
The health board would be in charge of that person, regardless of their setting, and they would have a midwife in the same as anybody else.
Okay, thanks for that. Any other questions from the committee? Yes, Rhoda?
To that, given that the bill... I'm just wondering where a residential or a prison setting becomes the same as a home setting, for instance, if medical attention wasn't required for the loss of, either a miscarriage or a stillbirth. Would the duties that fall on the hospital fall on whoever was employed by the state, or would it be left in the hands of the woman herself?
Well, In every situation, the health board is the authority that has the duty of care for that person.
But where a miscarriage, for instance, happens at home, the health board don't have to take steps. That remains in the woman's decisions, surely. But where it does happen in a hospital, then the health board have...
attracted to the health board as well, so if a person goes to their GP, it's part of the health service.
But if there is not a medical professional involved, does somebody at the prison or the residential centre take on those duties?
Well, I would have thought, and having been a prison visitor for 14 years before I came in here, the duty of care of the prison service would probably make sure that a medical professional was called if someone was having a miscarriage, especially if it was in later stages of the pregnancy.
Maybe need some clarity in that, one last one here in terms of the bill, of course, creates an offence for providing false or misleading information. Should it also specify in the bill whose role it is to explain the options and the forums for the cremation and burial?
In terms of, are you talking about in terms of a woman, explaining the options to a woman who's had a stillbirth or a...
Well, you know, it lays out an offence for providing false or misleading information. So should it equally lay out who should be responsible for that? And you know, in terms of the hierarchy, you know, if you're going to face criminal proceedings for some people could argue that the false and misleading information was incorrect information and not necessary. I suppose that would be for the courts to sort out. But you know, if you're going to set this up with a consequence that somebody who at that point was filling in those forums, having that discussion, then there's quite a serious consequence if they get it right. So people could get averse to be, you know, to be playing a part in that process if they felt that there was a severe outcome if they get it wrong. So should it not describe who should be ultimately responsible for carrying out that collection information, completing the forms correctly, given that there's such a consequence if they get it wrong?
The intention behind the offence is really in response to somebody who deliberately provides false information. So, for example, somebody who doesn't have the right to make the application for a cremation, or somebody who provides false information to cover up a crime, for example. Mm-hmm. It's intended to capture that scenario. It's not intended to capture the scenario where somebody simply... accidentally or to the best of their knowledge puts in information that turns out to be incorrect. So if somebody fills in a cremation application form and they accidentally provide the deceased's middle name incorrectly, we wouldn't view that as being an offence. However, in terms of who provides advice on the filling out of the form, we would look very much to funeral directors in a lot of instances, but also to NHS staff and healthcare staff generally. We'll provide guidance to both of those parties as part of the implementation process. And as part of the implementation process, we'll work with those parties to make sure that they understand what their responsibilities are. It's also worth saying that the person who completes the form should be the applicant. It shouldn't be a funeral director completing a form on behalf of somebody. It shouldn't be hospital staff completing the form on behalf of someone, unless that person has authorised the hospital to organise the cremation or the burial on their behalf.
So this is a form that they'll be left with then?
Not necessarily left with. I mean, by all means, they'll be given support there and then to complete the form. Our intention, and the forms haven't been finalised yet, our intention is that the applicant will sign the form to declare that they understand the consequences of their decisions. For example, they understand if they choose a shared cremation, they won't get ashes back, and that they have completed the form to the best of their knowledge, accurately and completely.
We had a description earlier from funeral directors who see a key role in their service is to take people through that forum, ask those questions, and then complete a forum. Would that practice change as a consequence?
One of the issues we're aware of, and I can't speak for particular funeral directors, is funeral directors completing forms on behalf of applicants. And so applicants not necessarily being given the full choice, because the funeral director has perhaps said, there you go, this is what we always do, we'll do this again. So we're trying to design the form so that it puts the onus on the applicant, the person who is applying for the funeral, to complete the form themselves, or at the very least to say, yes, I have understood everything that's been asked of me and I have given answers to all of those. By all means, funeral directors should be there to support and guide somebody through it, but it shouldn't be a funeral director who's completing the form for an applicant.
On the other side, we've got midwives who might wish to help somebody through that fund, but would be uncomfortable about recommending or assisting, talking about, you know, the a cremation and a burial or whatever, you know. So, do you know, given your response, do we not need some clarity in and around who should be involved in that forum filling if there's a... You're clearly saying that the only the key person involved in this is that nearest relative or the mother.
Well, initially, when there's a pregnancy loss, the woman is probably still going to be in a hospital setting and therefore will have that kind of discussion with a midwife or a doctor. But if she decides that she wants to take control of how the remains are disposed of, then that may be the point at which a funeral director may come in.
Mm-hmm. She's also got choices at that point whether she wants to take the remains away. Yes. And we've heard this morning they're typically in for 1 or 2 days. Right. They're in the hospital setting for 1 or 2 days. So on the day that she suffered pregnancy loss for some people, desperately got home, get out of the clinical situation, that's the day that she would be presented with some of these forums or some of these options and choices.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, the bill says that a health authority has to try and ascertain the woman's views within 7 days of experiencing the loss. So they have that 7-day period, which is to allow the woman to recover, because we have heard stories, as I'm sure you have, of women being asked to make decisions far too close to the loss occurring to have any understanding of what they truly want. So that's why we've built in this 7-day period, during which the 7 days from the loss occurring, during which the health authority should try and ascertain the woman's wishes. Now, whether that means that the woman gives her view while she's still in hospital, or goes home and then returns to the hospital, potentially, yes.
Rhoda, and then Bob.
I think some of those answers are a bit concerning, because certainly what we were hearing about the single form, and one of the defences for the single form was that a funeral director would be carrying it out, and some of the questions that didn't apply to a stillbirth or the like would not be put to the mother, i.e., you know, marital status, employment, all the things that their child wasn't going to enjoy could be quite distressing to have to answer. And what we were said, well, if there was one form and the funeral director was filling it out, obviously that question wouldn't be put. But now if you're saying actually the very opposite is true, and it is the person who has suffered that bereavement that is filling in that form, then the distress that form could create for that person would be huge. And again, going back to the, if they weren't doing it there and then and they had to plough through this huge form at some point, going back to the hospital to do it was a real concern. And if they didn't want to go back to the hospital and do it there and then, that could be hugely distressing. It seems like some of what you're telling us of the practicalities is actually flying in the face of kind of the defence for some of the things that was in the bill.
Well, I think as we said earlier, we haven't decided on the forms and we are consulting on what the forms should look like. But it is to capture, the forms will be designed to capture what is required to be captured, but yet to be as sensitive as they possibly can be. And, you know, we've tried to say that the options for a woman in this situation will have to be explained as soon as possible, but then she will have the option to take time to decide what she wants to do. But if, for example, she wanted to deal with the remains herself or wanted them disposed of in a certain way where a funeral director would normally be involved, then you would get the funeral director involved at that stage. But in terms of all cremations and burials, what Simon was trying to say, that often the funeral director, well, in some cases, the funeral director takes too much responsibility, him or herself, rather than putting the person's relatives in the driving seat.
And can I add just one more thing on the design of the forms, if I may? As the Minister quite rightly says, the format of the forms is still being discussed. The option of a single form wouldn't require every single question to be answered by every single applicant. The path that led us to thinking about a single form was when we looked at individual forms for different categories, we realised that there was quite a lot of similarities across the forms. So, for example, one of the options would be to have the form divided into sections. The first section would be for the personal details of the person applying for the cremation or the burial. Depending on who the deceased was, they would then be directed to another section of the form. So, for example, if it was a pregnancy loss, they would be directed to a section of the form which had questions which were relevant to the pregnancy loss, and so wouldn't ask questions about marital status and things like that. So that's one of the ways we would try to avoid people being asked that kind of inappropriate and insensitive question.
Dennis, do you?
Maybe just a little bit of clarity here, if I may. Forms for many people are a barrier for a great number of people, but in a situation where we're looking at bereavement, surely the only thing that we do require is that the person has a full and comprehensive understanding of what has been completed. And if a funeral director who has maybe years of experience and is sensitive to the bereaved and grieving relatives, surely it would be okay for that person to aid, assist and even complete, providing the person then signs the form off. Because you're surely not asking the bereaved and grieving parents to complete the form, are you?
I think what we're saying is that if a person wants someone like the funeral director to complete the form for them, that's okay. But it's them. Yeah. I think it is.
Well, I must have misunderstood.
But the responsibility for the form, as I understand it, rests with the person who's making the application. So you don't want anybody else to be filling up the form on your behalf if it's not correct.
Well,
so
indeed I would. I would actually prefer someone else who was guiding me through that form and through that process, who had the knowledge, experience, to aid myself or anyone else to go through that process, because they've got the knowledge, the experience, and indeed some of the questions may not be pertinent to that bereaved family. So at the end of the day, I think we're only saying that, well, my understanding would be providing the bereaved and grieving relatives understand and fully understand what has been completed and then signs the forms, surely to goodness it would be okay for a funeral director who has vast experience in these matters to aid and assist in the completion of that form.
I think the point we're making is that responsibility ultimately rests with the applicant. But if I think we're all agreed that if a person wants to be guided by a funeral director or somebody else in completing the form, that's perfectly all right.
Nicely, I actually think Mr. Robertson and the Minister might have been saying the same thing. I mean, I don't think anyone's too interested in whose ballpoint pen is on a form other than the signature, as long as the person, the applicant, is fully cognizant and understands the form that has been completed and it's done appropriately and sensitively, whether via a funeral director or whether in an NHS setting, which I think brings us full circle to the convener's question earlier on in relation to to provide false or misleading information in relation to giving advice to the completion of that form does become an offence. So I think the clarity that maybe we were looking for at the start would be whose responsibility would it be to give that advice and information in relation to the completion of that form. So I suppose the best example I could give, if it was a corporate funeral directing company, would it be the individual who sat with the family member, or would it be the manager of that funeral company? So would it be a corporate responsibility of the funeral company, or would it be the individual who was taking the applicant through that process? So if it was an NHS, would it be the individual midwife or nurse who was giving advice and information whilst the form has been completed, or would it be the ward manager, or would it be a senior clinician? So it does overlap slightly in relation to the other piece of legislation, Minister, that you're bringing through the Parliament. It's relation to, so advice should be given, I think we're saying that. So when these forms are filled in, appropriate advice and information should be given to bereaved parents, to the mum. That might be done in an NHS setting, that might be done by funeral directors, but if that advice is given in a deliberately false and misleading way, that's an offence. So the clarity is, who's guilty of that offence potentially? Is it a corporate responsibility, or is it the responsibility of the individual who's seemingly giving that advice at the time? And if that requires more thought, that's fine, but I think that's what we're trying to tease out, and really, and hopefully it's something that never happens, but I think, you know, people would want us to make sure that there's clarity in relation to that.
It's not the advice that's is likely to be causing an offence. It's what's written down on the form has to be true and accurate. And that, in the end of the day, is the responsibility of the person making the application, not any of the people giving the advice.
Yeah, my apologies. I'm only reading from a briefing paper, so I'll have to go back and check the details of the bill. But just from the...
Go away and see if anything on the face of the bill needs clarifying in relation to that, and bring through forward a stage 2 amendment.
But as in connection to the cremation application forms, absolutely. So I assume someone would be sitting with the bereaved parent as they're filling in that form, and that, you know, some information and clarity would be given by the person who's taken them through that process. And it's whether, if that was ever misleading, we would hope never, but would the offence be the individual that's taken them through that forum, or would it sit elsewhere, and how do we know who that person is? But maybe that's one to come back on.
I've no further questions, a bid for questions from the committee. Can I thank you, Minister, and your colleagues for your attendance here and the evidence provided. Thank you very much indeed. We now proceed to agenda item number 4, which is in previously agreed in private session. Thank you. We clear the room quickly. We'll make